The opinions expressed on this program are those of the host or guests and should not be interpreted as statement of fact. Independent fact-checking and corrections are encouraged.
Can we get a cup of coffee in here, please?
Hot.
Wake up, America. You've got a dog that needs walking. That's right, sunshine. Just put on a big pot of strong coffee and get ready to type your little hate mail with your opinions about kumbaya and flat earth insanity. Stand-up comedy? You want stand-up comedy? Well, we've got sit-down comedy. It's time for Coffee with the Dog. You make me laugh.
Yeah. Sure. Laugh all you want. Blah, blah, blah. I'm not going to make you laugh, but hopefully my guest today will make you laugh. How about it for the band? Come on, put your hands together for the band. Actually, send them some money. Send the band some money, but you can send it to me and I'll give it to the band. Lots of money. Oh, shaking off the cobwebs I am. Good morning, folks. It is Tuesday, August 29th, 2023. I hope you're having a beautiful day wherever you are. I'd like to wish a happy birthday to Andy Baker, Hack Oddity. 39 years old today. Man, I was just thinking about 39. 39 was a good time. But I did go through some things at 39. You know, 40 was really scary for me. For some reason, 40 was like ancient. I take 40 in a heartbeat. Anyway, happy birthday, Andy. Make the best of it, your last year of your 30s. I don't know. The world is yours. Anyway, today, Marina Franklin will be our guest somewhere around 9:15. I look forward to talking to her. She's a very funny young lady, kicking ass in a man's world, as they say. And so there's that. So she'll make you laugh. I don't think I will make you laugh today. But I got to start off by saying, I don't, wait, here comes Jordan Peterson. He'll tell you about it. I don't put a lot of weight into dreams and predictions and that kind of stuff, but I'm a little troubled this morning. I'm a little freaked out. Well, first of all, I had two really vivid dreams in the night, and I don't generally have vivid dreams that I remember. But one, I found myself expressing regret. I don't know, to a room full of fucking people that I don't know, strangers, like you, about my mistreatment of a guy named Paul Harris, 15 years ago or so, longer than 15 years ago, before Facebook, before, I think people were on MySpace. Paul Harris was a guy who was from my hometown, and we were on classmates.com. He accused me of bullying him, but I was a bit of an asshole to him, and I regret being an asshole to him. But he kept using the word bully, like, because, you know, I have very strong opinions then, and I have very strong opinions now, and I'm sure I was very rude to the guy. Bully? No, I never threatened to beat him up. I kind of pummeled them with verbal arguments, though, and I feel bad about it. I felt bad about it. And it hit me last night. For some reason, it was on my mind. And then this morning, I'm checking my Facebook memories, and he's there in my Facebook memories from 12 years ago. I guess we reconciled somehow, and he became my friend on Facebook. and he was saying some nice things to me. And it's really weird that I was dreaming about him, dreaming about my regret about, you know, being a dick to him. And then there he was in my Facebook memories. That's kind of weird. I know it's coincidence. The other dream I had was about our friend William Conway. And this concerned me because I have been concerned about the reason I'm not talking to Willie at this point or not really following him is I've been concerned about the choices he made to move to South Dakota, leave his wife behind and just chase the comedy dreams and music dreams in South Dakota. And following the lead of one really misguided thought leader, guru, positive energy, and I don't even want to mention his name, guy. And I know I had a dream that Willie was back in New Mexico and reaching out for help because he had hit a time of depression. Now, I don't want to share too much about it, but Willie has had, and as far as I know, this is a lifelong thing, suicidal ideation. And when you have somebody like that, you know, they're always, people say, well, yeah, they talk about it, but everybody talks about it. Everybody who ever committed suicide talked about it. And they talked about it a lot, and it took a while before they actually did it. And people always say, it's just talk, you know, and they talk about it. And then one day they actually do it. So I was concerned about Willie, and then somebody DM'd me and said, have you seen the news about Willie? And I was like, oh, no, I was expecting the worst. But they said, looks like he went back to New Mexico. That's fucking weird, because I was just dreaming that he went back to New Mexico. I hope he's doing well. If anybody knows and they want to share information, I hope he's okay. Because I was concerned about him. I woke up with a very concerned feeling about him. Anyway, I don't put, a lot of stock into dreams, but when two of them like that, and I don't really have vivid dreams that I remember. And then when it comes back like that, I get a little, I don't know, wow, that's weird. That's just weird, man. Anyway, that's that. I got the dog. I've been dog watching and not doing a great job at it. The dog, she's a lovely dog. She's a golden retriever. She's very friendly, very, people dog. She likes people. I've taken her for walks, and she doesn't seem to know that the guy with the leash is in charge. Or maybe I'm just doing it wrong. I've walked dogs my whole life. I never had a problem controlling a dog. But this dog does not seem to really want to cooperate, especially on the walks and stuff. And we have a lot of dogs in the neighborhood, and she wants to get to know them all. Now, they don't all want to get to know her. I'm just hoping that her mom comes home early today because I just... Yeah, I'm too old to be taking on retraining an adult dog. I don't think she was necessarily trained very well right from the start on how to go for walks. I think what happened, because my stepdaughter, whose dog it is, she used to live here. And I think she used to just let her out in the backyard, never really take her for walks. But I can't just do that. And then, you know, when you do that, you never know what they're going to get into because... Anyway, so the dog thing is a bit of a challenge to me, and 2.5 days, almost 3 days, is enough. I love her. I love this dog. She's a very sweet dog. But I'd like to see her go home today. I'm a typical grandpa type of thing. Yeah, I love the kids, but it's enough. Anyway, getting swamped. I already had 5 gigs for Labor Day weekend lined up. 5. and then picked up another one yesterday, making it 6, and another one this morning, making it 7, and possibly another one waiting to hear on. It'd be 8 gigs from Friday to Monday. I don't know if I've ever done that. I think my record, I have to look this up. I think my record is 7 gigs in a weekend. And I know Monday doesn't, in the real world, Monday would not count as part of a weekend. So maybe this, maybe that's a saving grace part of it. People texting me. Why do people always wait till I'm doing this to text me? And that screws with the stream. Try to test out my stream yesterday. Still having issues with it. I don't know. We're going to have to probably switch platforms. I think it's StreamYard. It's definitely not my internet connection. I have fast internet. I really have the fastest we can get here. I can't get Verizon's fiber optic line here for some reason. The reason is I'm too far out in the sticks to get it. But this is really, we never had this trouble. For the first 5 years I did this fucking show, never had a problem with it. But I'm not seeming to be able to kind of rectify the problem. Try different browsers, all that kind of stuff. It's not going well. Before my guest gets here, I'm going to play some commercials to get them out of the way, and I'll be right back because we have a kind of a busy day here, and I want to end it pretty early today so I can go take care of the dog. I'm just nervous about it. I don't want the dog shitting in the house. Basically, that's what it comes down to. Don't want the dog shitting in the house. I'll be right back. Get yourself some delicious Koa coffee, and I'll be right back. This episode is brought to you by Koa Coffee. If you are a coffee connoisseur and want to experience the best coffee Hawaii has to offer, no blends, no compromise, try the true taste of aloha. Koa Coffee produces premium Hawaiian coffee, hand-picked, expertly roasted, and delivered from Hawaii to your door with aloha. From award-winning 100% Kona coffee grown on the slopes of the Mauna Loa volcano to the unique mocha beans of Maui, they strive to provide their loyal customers with the best quality and freshness. Since 1997, Koa Coffee has been known far and wide as a product of utmost quality, and their awards prove it. Koa Coffee was featured in Forbes' Top 10 Coffees of the World. This is the coffee Forbes called the best coffee in America. Find out what it's all about. Go to minddogtv.com/coffee. And there she goes. Hello. Turn around. Would you like to walk the dog with me? And you know what I mean by walking the dog, don't you? Yeah, so Sticks and Stones Comedy Club. This weekend, Friday, Marina Franklin and Matt Ritter. Matt Ritter will be here tomorrow. And also Diane Forrest, who will be here tomorrow. Diane Forrest is the legendary Diane Forrest and friends tomorrow night. Oh, she'll be there Saturday night, but she'll be here tomorrow. She's a Guinness World Record holder. Now, I don't know for what. What is she the Guinness World Record holder for? This is what I'm not sure about. Called the Naughty Betty. This is from her bio. Called the Naughty Betty White. Now, Betty White was pretty naughty herself, so I don't know. The Naughty Betty White. Diane Forrest holds the Guinness World Record for the oldest working female comedian in the world at 89. I thought she was 86, which is astonishing in itself. 89, for her birthday is July 31st, so she just turned 89. Good for her. Wow. She called me yesterday and was on the phone. I was like in the middle of a very stoned nap. And she called, and I was confused at first because, you know, I thought we'd be emailing back and forth about setting up for tomorrow. but I could tell I was talking to an older person. But 89, my goodness, man. Imagine, see, we're not just living longer. We're living better longer. good morning, Ian. Ian says 89 house. We won't even ask that. but you know what? There's quality of life and there's length of life. You know what? Maybe. Do I have this wrong? I think I might have this wrong. I think I'm just looking at this. Maybe Marina might not be here until 10:15. That could be the problem. I got her for 9:15, 9 a.m. to 10 a.m. So she's expecting now. I will check on her because it's 9:15 now and she's not here. But I was about to talk about, because I got Tommy Chong on next week. I think Tommy's 84 now. He might be 85, which is old, but he's young. He's probably in better shape than I am. He's dancing with the stars. Listen, it doesn't take much to be in better shape than I am. But Tommy's 84. Robert Klein, who has been on the program, 82 now. Diane Forrest, who will be here tomorrow, 89 years old. God bless her. And still, she'll be at Sticks and Stones Saturday night. Still doing, you know, stand-up. God bless her, man. People think stand-up is easy. I mean, you're just standing there with a microphone, right, and talking. It's not. But just standing up at 89 for an hour, give her credit for that. But being able to, yeah, you have no idea. I'm going to be playing on Saturday afternoon for a nursing home, and I think probably the oldest resident there will be 89. Nobody in the room will even be able to get out of their wheelchair and not that they can't stand. They can probably stand up, but then quickly sit down. 89, she's still performing. That alone, that's worth the price of a ticket anyway. But today, we're going to talk to our guest who's going to be at Sticks and Stones this Friday night. Marina Franklin is a veteran comedian, actor, writer, and host whose long tenure as a stand-up standout at premier comedy venues and festivals around the world, alongside her memorable TV and film appearances and critically acclaimed podcasts, have made her a fan favorite and in-demand creative force. And she's here now. I don't know if she's ready now, but we'll find out. Welcome in Marina Franklin to the Mind Dog.
Hi. Hello. Good morning.
Good morning. Now, I'm interested in a critically acclaimed podcast. Who's doing the critically acclaiming of podcasts around here?
Oh, I am. No, we were listed on Oprah's favorite thing. So,
oh, Oprah.
I would think that counts. Hopefully.
Absolutely.
I don't know. Does she still count?
Yes, absolutely. She's still, you know what? People talk about Rogan and his influence now, like he's the new Oprah, but she's still one of the most influential people in the world. And good for you. I thought maybe there was some kind of podcast critique website I could go look at there and see who's critically acclaiming these things. Podcasting is it's changed the world in a big way in that anybody can have a show. Not everybody should have a show.
That's right. That's true.
But congratulations. I've watched Single Black Female. Loved it. Is that the current special, or did you have another one that was
That's
out?
It. Yeah. I only have one special. It's Single Black Female. It came out right before 2020. And then the CW aired it as well.
Wow. Very cool. I didn't know about CW. I don't have television in my house, so everything I do has to be online. I have to find it in a digital format. And sometimes,
good for you. You're like the millennials.
Well, television isn't good for me. It's like a drug. It's poison. It's addictive, and it just takes up too much of your life. And so I got rid of it, and then like a true addict, I look for it sourced another way, and I find it on a computer. But it does force you to actually seek out what you want rather than be spoon-fed just information constantly. So
that is true.
Yeah. Are you a native New Yorker?
No, I'm originally from Chicago, but at this point, it feels like I'm a native New Yorker. I've lived here for 25 years. So that, I mean, I I'm already, you know, I've got that look in my eye, like, oh, every day. It's happening. So I am really excited to be in the Hamptons. That's, you know, I'm that person that needs it for escape. I say it on stage all the time. It's like, in order to love New York, you have to leave it a lot.
Yeah. Well, now the Hamptons, have you performed there before?
I have. I performed years ago with Joseph Vessi. He did a show at a theater there. I forget the name of the theater because it's been a while. It's been like 7 years.
Yeah.
But I did it twice. I did it once. And I believe, like, and then I headlined. I did a feature show. It was a couple of us. And then I headlined at a theater. I cannot remember. Sorry for not remembering the actor, though. It's his theater. He's like this old veteran actor. He's no longer with us, unfortunately. He was in the Fright Night. Like, he played the vampire or whatever. Anyway.
Yeah, interesting, because I was thinking there. It was the Guild, but then I thought, when you said that, I was like, well, what theater is she talking about? Anyway, the Hamptons are all different, and Southampton is more comedy friendly than I think a lot of the Hamptons, because it's a party, you know, in the summertime anyway, and this is the end of the summer kickoff here.
Is it the Black Side? No.
No, I don't think that, you know what? There isn't a Black Hampton. There should be a Black Hampton.
I'm always missing out. I saw like I think it was 2 weeks ago. I saw Obama was there was a big thing. Everyone was like, "Are you in the Hamptons?" I was like, "What am I missing?"
Yeah, and that was in Amagansett. And my friend who knows Barack Obama was at that party, a photographer, and I was like, "Why would you not take me there? I mean, I've done so many favors for this guy. It's like I don't ask for much. I just want to just." You know, press the flesh of really famous people and say, well.
This is my goal in life. It's not to be the most successful comedian, really. It's to be the one that can go to the Hamptons for that weekend when all the black stars go. Like, I have the spot. That's all I want.
But now, we could talk about race because I want to talk about race.
Why not?
But I'd like to start with being a female comedian in a world that is dominated by men, and you're kicking ass in it, and that's a great thing. But how? I mean, how is that? It's a struggle, right? To even compete with the men, and not necessarily because of talent, but because of preconceived notions. I have friends who say women just aren't funny, and I'm
still?
Like, yeah, you know,
that's exactly. Been? It's like that's no longer. I don't hear that as much anymore because things have changed. I mean, I work at the Comedy Cellar in New York. That's my home club, and I would say, like, you know, I started there 20 years ago. I was one of the few then. It was like me, Jessica Kirsten, Lynn Coplitz. It would be me, Jessica Kirsten, Lynn Coplitz. Me, Jessica. Now there is like at least like I'm on the stage and there's Aaron Jackson. There's Joel Johnson. There's Amina Amani. There's so many female comics now working that club. And I see finally for the first time, I see the audience really excited to see women comics on the stage. And I don't hear that phrase as much. And when I do hear it, if it sounds like dated.
Yeah. Well, I had a guest on who was, she was built herself as New Jersey's second funniest comedian. When I talked about it, she said, no, it's second funniest female comedian. I was like, why do we still need that distinction?
You don't.
Right.
I agree.
Yeah, it's just weird. If you're a comedian, you're a comedian, but we hear all the time the phrase female comedian is still part of our lexicon. It's very strange.
Yeah.
You wouldn't see in any other profession, I don't think. Well, maybe.
No, every profession, it's called equal pay. Not yet. Yet yeah. There.
I guess. I was thinking, you know, doctor, I wouldn't hear female doctor anymore.
But doctors, female doctors get it too, because I once on my podcast, which by the way is called Friends Like Us, on my podcast, I made the mistake myself of referring to the doctor with her full name. And she said, could you please refer to me as doctor? And she said she would get that all the time in a room where the male doctors would be referred to as doctors and she would be referred to by her name.
That is really interesting because I interview lots of doctors and I always refer to them as doctor. And they said, you don't have to call me, especially the ladies will say, you can just call me by my name, which is, and I'm wondering if it's a dynamic because you're female and I'm male. So you have to call them doctor.
I think it's when it's in a group aspect and then they'll notice it when they're the only female there.
Right. Yeah. Very cool. So now let's talk a little bit about race, because I think it was in the special or maybe another video clip I saw.
It is called Single Black Female. Yeah. It's in the title.
Right. But when they showed the audience, I saw far more black people in the audience than I would for, you know, a white guy. And I'm just wondering, is that part of the experience in comedy is like people will gravitate racially towards the same race as them to go to see. I don't see any white guys. And I know one white guy who's proud of this. And he says all the time, all he does is play black clubs in Chicago and Indianapolis and all that. I'm like, that's really weird. But that's the only one I know of that will actually, you see a white guy in front of a large.
Bill Burr used to perform in front of black audiences all the time when I was coming up. Oh. So that's not rare.
Yeah. So with you, though, was that a correct observation on me, or is that just that one-off?
That was just maybe a one-off. I mean, that audience was very mixed. It was actually more white than it was black, but that's because, you know, like, and I was just talking about this on another show, like, black audiences gravitate towards who they know. They go out to spend money, and it's going to be through someone that they know. Right. So, like, if you're up and coming, it's a little difficult to get that audience if you're not like a social media influencer, or if you're like just not like Cat Williams, let's say, or Kevin Hart. It's just a different way. And I've been like pushing and saying to my audience, you have to go out and see all forms of black comedy, not just the ones you know. Support the ones you don't know. Support the ones that are coming up. Just give them a chance. We're a little bit more fickle with that. We'll get the, I ain't going to see nobody who ain't, I don't know, and I don't know if they funny or not. You know, so, and that's me just stereotyping, of course, a whole group of people with that voice. Yes. And what I'm saying is, I get black, I get Latino, I get white. My whole story is that I grew up in a white neighborhood and then I moved to a black neighborhood, and that I actually do, I can't help it, I'm kind of a chameleon. I could do white, bilingual. I could go, oh my God. And then so that's the whole thing, is like I appeal to all audiences. And in honesty, it's like the best audience is a mixed audience. I never like it to be all one thing.
Right. I agree. Now, do you, and I know politics is not your thing, but do you think,
I do it in a more subtle way.
Or I actually heard you say, I think it was on Conan one time.
Did I?
That you don't, do, and this is how long back I remember seeing you on television when I had television.
You said,
I don't do politics on stage. And that's what you.
Was it in my act? It was probably like a way of doing it. That sometimes I'll do that. I'll joke about how I don't do it just so I can do it.
That makes sense. Yeah. Yeah. But do you think race relations are improving in America?
That's funny.
Yeah, I know.
I mean, I think it's definitely, you know, we just had that march with Martin Luther King held by Al Sharpton. The thing is, I think that overall things are definitely better, but we're also going backwards in other ways, not just for the black community, but also for LGBTQ community. As you see, historically, they're like banning books in Florida. They're telling, you know, like not trying to show like history the way it needs to be taught. So And we just had some violence that happened this week. We don't want to
get
that. That's sad. But it's true. It's like we have a lot of radicalism that's going on in America that's really scary. So I would say that you can't really say it's better when you've just had like three people who were taken out by someone who hated Black people.
Right. To me, it's so weird that it seems like some of us are growing. Some of us are becoming more human and understanding of everybody is, you know, people and all that stuff. We don't even refer to, the opposition, the people who disagree with us. We don't even refer to them as people a lot of times. We just, you know, we come up with other ways of describing them.
Those people.
Yeah. But they don't even use the word people. I think it's important to use the word people. At least that kind of reminds you that we're all people and, you know, we all have a right to exist and all that kind of stuff. But one-on-one, I think, you know, in relations, I think I see a lot of improvement. The problem is we get these groups and we have definitely a segment of white society. It sounds like I'm, you know, white guilting here. I'm not. But we have a segment of white society that is going, like you said, moving backwards and really worshiping Archie Bunkers of the world like they were heroes.
Well, Archie Bunker was even kind of better. He was at least hilarious.
Yeah.
I do think that there is a small segment of people, like you were saying, like what we just had about the migrant situation in New York just yesterday where people were shouting, go home, we don't want you here. Like that is a small segment of New York, but it's shown in the media as if it represents the whole. And we don't even know who those people are and where they come from. Like sometimes those people come from, do you know some of those people?
Well, no, they come from Staten Island. I know Staten Island. Listen,
is that your friend?
No. I know, you know, parts of New York, there are, unfortunately, this is stereotyping, but there are areas, Howard Beach was very racist when I was growing up. I mean, all that kind of stuff. Staten Island has been very racist my whole life. It is people like me, Italian, third generation Italian Americans who grew up and forgot that they were immigrants and just hate everybody and just think that they were, you know, real Americans. It's all about...
Yeah, and that they love disco. Let's not forget. I've seen you. I've seen y'all on the dance floor.
Yeah. Well, you won't see me on the dance floor ever again.
Oh, no.
I'm too old.
Oh, come on. You can get down. Yeah, have you seen my videos? Go to my Instagram.
Yes, I have. I actually have seen a video. You're dancing on a dock somewhere. And I was like,
I'm dancing on Pier 76.
Yeah, okay. Yeah. It looks easy enough, but at my age, it's like I probably break a hip.
We're probably the same age.
I doubt it. I have a birthday tomorrow. I'll be 64.
Oh, okay. Well, I'm in the 50s.
Wow, you definitely have a very youthful appearance.
Thank you.
So
I talk about it too, because it's time to show and tell your age. I never got anything from hiding it.
Well,
so,
I have a guest on tomorrow who's 89 and still doing stand-up.
I know. I heard you talking about that. I think that is so amazing because, you know, the myth of what's happening in the industry or the sadness of what's happening in the industry right now is that they're starting to show younger comics, but comedy gets better as you get older. You have more to talk. You have so much more life to talk about. So 89. Wow.
Yeah. Yeah. And when we talked about sexism and genders and race, let's talk about it because I'm of the opinion that young people, 20 somethings, aren't comedy club people. They're not comedy club fans. Do you agree with that? Because I think the target audience should start at 30 no matter what. Maybe I'm wrong about that, but I don't see a lot.
That's not the numbers. The numbers show that the 20-year-olds go out, and as they get older, they start to stay home and chill.
Yeah, I could see that.
So 30s, yes, but I would say as you get older, but so audiences like to go out. Like kind of like what we were talking about, audiences like to see themselves. And a lot of times I'll see this, a young girl would like to see someone that looks like them And so a lot of times I'll get girls in cities that'll go, I came to see you just because you're a girl and I haven't seen a girl here. And I want to hear that voice. So that happens too with youth. You like, they'll want to see someone that represents their generation.
Well, that's a difficult thing because being a comedian requires some life experience. There are very few who break through in teens and early 20s and break through in a big way in pop.
Chappelle did. Chappelle was very young. Eddie Murphy.
Yeah, Chappelle, Eddie Murphy or two. Freddie Prinze is the only other one I can think of. I'm sure there are others.
Michael Shea was very young.
Really?
Yeah, he made it in like within 3 years. It's very rare. But
what do you attribute that to? Is that
luck?
Is it
he's
luck?
Also very talented. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, being in the right place and being talented and being a guy. Going back to that. All the combination. It was a perfect storm for him.
Right.
Plus, he is very likable. People like Michael J.
Yeah. Yeah, I could see that. You know, because it's unusual to hear somebody who's successful talk about luck. I think luck is a real thing. I don't know how I would define it, but I think talent is definitely not enough. Hard work is not enough. Sometimes you just need that lucky break. I talked to one guy and he about these names, the A-list celebrities that everybody knows, and like, what's the difference between them and people who are just as talented, working their ass off trying to make it? And there is no real difference, substantial difference between the content of what they're delivering. It's and he said he believes in destiny, like the hand of God, you know, reaches down and touches some people. Well, you know, you are destined to be one of these people that are celebrated in a big name. Like, yeah, I don't want to name all the names, but you know what I'm talking about. Those people who are just bigger than life. What do you attribute that to? Is it because it's not just luck or hard work or that superstar or light shining on you?
Well, there are gatekeepers. And that's real. It took Louie a while. Louie talked about that. Louie C.K. talked about the gatekeepers that kept him out for a very long time. And then he broke through. So, and when he broke through, I don't know. I think he just made a decision to work harder. I remember even Bill Burr saying, I'm going to do some of the things these guys who aren't as good as me doing. I'm going to change it up. So I think it is something in an individual who knows that moment in time, exactly when and how to switch it up and to make it regardless of what gatekeeper is out there. And that is a rare thing. You know, not everyone knows how to do that. And it's a hard, hard industry because of the gatekeepers. What we're having right now with the writer's strike and the SAG strike is we're learning that these are corporations who make the decisions. Really, at the end of the day, when you think about it, it's like, I just thought it was my joke that was funny. No, there's a corporation behind who and what they want. So they make these decisions. So, you know, your look could be keeping you back. I don't know.
Right.
It could be all it's so many things. And then on top of that, this is a very it's a very small world where you can burn bridges with people that you didn't know were going to become successful at some point. So you ever hear that phrase? Like, it's amazing. It's not a phrase. I never get phrases right. I don't know why I just said it, but you know, like it's amazing that a show ever happens or ever gets on the air. And that is because there's so many people in this industry who knew or didn't know. And they're like, I didn't like that person. I'm not going to put their show on. And that really, really does happen. And then you have disagreements. So it's just all of that. There's a word for it. I don't have big words, but there is a word for that. Maybe you can find the word. I don't know.
Yeah, somebody will Google it and somebody in the chat will let me know.
It's a good word.
Yeah. Have you reached, and because I've known about you for years now, but I'm the level of fame that it becomes where fame is a negative. Like, because I think about this all the time. When I was young, I wanted to be famous. I wanted to be a name everybody knows. And as I got older, I took a lot of comfort in not having that part of having a private life and having not being famous, not being someone that everybody recognizes anywhere. Have you reached a level of where it becomes annoying?
I'm famous. What are you talking about? I mean, I'm well known. I'm fine with where I'm at. You know, like, people do know who I am. I, you know, people come out, they know my podcast. They know me from Chappelle's show, Last Comic Standing, Tough Crowd with Colin Quinn. So I'm not like not known. And I do like the level that I'm at. Yeah. I think that as far as fame goes, you know, being well known, fame now doesn't necessarily mean you're good. Because as we're seeing, social media is starting to dictate who's getting seen in stand-up. So you could have like a minute clip and it just goes viral because you ate ice cream in a funny way. Yeah. And then you're selling out a club, right?
Right.
And we just came out of a pandemic where you can't blame the clubs because they have to fill seats. But what happens is that audience doesn't return because they say that person couldn't do like 5 minutes. So I think that the level of fame the definition of it has definitely changed in 2023. You know, so I'm okay with not being that type of famous. What I think is at any point, anybody can be really well known and good at the same time. And that's what I'm always striving for. And that's where I'm at right now.
Very good.
Yeah. I mean, I think it's always about what you're putting out and believing in your content and making sure and knowing that the fans that you have are really there for you. And you got to stick with those fans because those fans are going to influence other fans to come see you.
Yeah. I hear what you're saying. And I think that's a great attitude to have. But I think a lot of the youth today, I think they are interested in fame without even thinking about what I want to be famous for. All that matters is fame. Like, there's no content, no what kind of value am I going to add to the world? What am I going to bring to the table? It's just I want to be famous for anything. And it could be eating ice cream.
Yes, it's really, but it's always been there. It's just, it's kind of like social media just shined a light on it. I mean, everyone wanted to be a star at some point. It was just different ways of doing it back in the day. Now with social media, it's like, oh my gosh, this person, look at how they laugh when they eat a sandwich. I'm like, that's talent?
Yeah.
What? I mean, you know, I went to 4 years of theater school. I studied the craft of acting. You know, I have the ability to act, but I also worked on it.
Right.
Comedy is something you do have to work on. There is no getting around it. No way around it. You have to. It is a craft. And slowly, sadly, what I do see happening is people are not really, as an audience, understanding what that craft is. Because you have a young generation right now. What they're seeing is crowd work on Instagram.
Right.
Well, they'll see someone go, hey, how, and I'm guilty of this. I just put one clip up myself because, hey, you know what? Join them. But someone said, you know, hey, how long you guys, you're dating? That's, you know, and if you're not doing that now in your act, the audience has been trained by social media to go and see that. And if you're not doing that, they're like, hey, there was no, you didn't ask me about my life.
I have really mixed feelings about this because there are people who use crowd work very effectively.
Oh yes, yes.
To make you feel like you're welcome, you're part of the audience. But then
they're good at it though.
Right. There are people who will complain about heckling after all they did was talk to the crowd the entire time, and then they're surprised that the crowd thinks that they're part of the show now.
Right, right. Well, especially that happens too, yeah.
After too much alcohol, you've been talking to us all night long. Now, what do you mean? You want to stop talking to me now?
Yeah. Well, that's like an actual, like, in the room problem, right?
Right.
But I've actually heard this, there's, Jim Norton does a great thing on his Instagram, which I love, where he does an example of what's going on social media, where he asks someone in the audience a question. He doesn't really deal with the answer, and he goes, all right, credits roll, He's done, and he gives you his dates, and he's just making a joke on this very trend that's going on.
Yeah, he likes to really take it out of himself when he puts a lot of bombing, you know, in his real. He puts every time a joke doesn't work, that's what he puts up,
it's
which is
great.
Now, because that's interesting, because I heard Louis C.K. talk about he doesn't buy into this. You got to, and of course, he can't. He was big enough before social media really became part of our lives, I think, but doesn't feel the need to, and doesn't understand the need to constantly put out content to. And I think he makes a point about that, because I think we are becoming oversaturated with everybody is on 15 podcasts, and there you be overexpose yourself to audiences. No, or do you agree?
Well, it's kind of the game right now. You're either someone said this, you know, it's the direction things are going in, and you don't want to be left behind. And it's sort of what they're looking at. And by them, I mean these corporations who make decisions, comedy clubs who book, agents, they also are putting that pressure on us to do it as well. I have a lot of material. So there's a plus side of it, right? Louis C.K. is established. He can say that. He has a lot of money, and he can sit back and say that. Someone like myself, still out there hustling, still working, needs to be seen. As you said, who knows Marina Franklin? A lot of people do, but a lot of people don't. So in a way, social media is giving them that chance to see someone that they never saw before and go, oh my gosh. So there's a lot of Black talent, speaking of, that, you know, we didn't know before, that started to put their specials out, and they got more viewers than the network said they would get. So right. That's the positive spin on it. And that is because they built up their social network. And those are comedians that are actually good. Right. So there's the good side of it, but there's always going to be also, you know, a bad side.
I can't count the number of comedians that I have found through just those reels on Instagram or Facebook or stuff that I've become huge fans of that I would not have known. Listen, there's so many people. You can't get out to a club to see everybody that's working today, right?
Yeah. Like my podcast, you know, Friends Like Us is the premise of it, is if it's features women of color speaking on hot topics, most of them are funny women, comedians. So I introduced the best compliment I ever got on the road was one time in DC, and most of my audience there was Black. And I had women coming up to me and thanking me for introducing them to comedians, other Black female comedians that they didn't know about. And now they're seeing them like rise to this level of fame. Janelle James, Aaron Jackson, you know, I've had Amy Schumer. No. I was gonna say she ain't Black, but she wanna be. No. Let's see who else. But I've had a lot of up and coming like stars that they just didn't know.
Right.
So they got to see them as they were developing as well. So that now, like, it's like DJs, you know how they break records? They break music and they introduce you to a new song. The whole goal of my show was to introduce you to a new comic that you didn't know before that was female of color. Now, once a month, we do have a white. It's our period. So we'll have like Amy Schumer. She's been on there like twice. Michelle Buteau, she's been on my show, you know, she's Black. Now I'm getting confused, but
I was like, wait a minute.
It's really about, it's kind of like also my job to introduce people to talent that they've never seen. And I get a lot of joy from doing it.
Very cool. Yeah. And you know what? My goal in life at this point is such a shallow goal. It's to be... it's to be able to find somebody who is a young, just starting out in the business, and be the first one to get them some exposure, and then hopefully before I die, be able to see their career blossom and see them become somebody really, you know, important in the genre. I feel like comedy is really underappreciated as far as what it means to us. And this is why I think, you know, you talk about you got to do the work and you got to struggle, but I think it's really unfair in the beginning because you got to work for nothing. I mean, in every other, even any other art form you work for, when you're just starting out, you got to hustle, but you still get paid something. You get a stipend or something. Now, at this, in comedy, it's the only art form that means so much to us. I do, and I maybe I'm on a soapbox here, but I feel like it truly is a healing art, and we all need it. It's vital. It's like air and water for us. You got to be able to laugh, and people just don't appreciate it enough, which is why comics start picking. You got to work for 10 years before you ever see $5.
Well, it is oversaturated in that way in certain areas like New York. Okay. I think, you know, New York, people come to New York to see comedy, but, you know, it's kind of like it's there. So we take it for granted. There's right. places where I'll go where you can almost feel the audience is like, oh, thank you. Oh, live entertainment. Oh, comedy. And I'm in front of you. They have this appreciation for it because it's not readily available to them.
Yeah.
So I see that, too.
Now, this is interesting because she did mention that people come to New York and see comedy. Is there a difference in what and how you work for playing for a tourist crowd rather than going to a city, like, I don't know, name any city in America where you might go to a comedy club? And you know those are people who live in that city. It's not a touristy city. But New York, people are at comedy clubs are generally not from New York. They're from Oshkosh or wherever. Is there a difference in the way you work for a touristy crowd rather than a hometown crowd?
Overall, it's the same, but there are subtle differences. Like if I go to LA and I'm talking about the train, they're like, we have cars, yeah. You know, and ooh. And you find that out just by doing the joke and it failing, or you get like a weird quiet sound that you're like, wait, what's that about? So like I would talk because I talk about the train and the MTA a lot and I trash it and all that and how they raise the prices and then but it's like the trains are delayed. So I'll you know, but also say the positive things about the train, like, you know, I love getting my seat on the train. And so those types of things don't resonate, obviously, in a place like Iowa or right. California. So you have to change it up. And they do come to New York. So, but the thing about a mixed crowd, no matter what type of mix it is, even if it's like tourist and New York in it, is the beautiful thing about a mixed audience is because they see someone else laughing at it, they go, oh, that must be funny. Let me pay attention. If it's all one thing and they've all agreed that they don't know it, they've all made a decision like a mob, I ain't laughing. So that's the beauty of New York is they're coming to see the story of New York. They get it. They're coming to see a New York comic. Yeah. When you go outside of New York, you go somewhere like, let's say even internationally, I used to travel a lot. I've been to South Africa, Amsterdam. I've been to Australia. I did a whole tour for almost over a month in Australia where I've been to more places in Australia than most Australians been. And I've had to perform for audiences that obviously aren't from New York, but my material lends itself to that. My material tends to be universal. And it's also like, you know, I'm doing the white person for you. I speak well, but you know, I don't have a colloquial like ism. Like I don't sound Brooklyn and I don't, like Chicago has that gift.
You don't sound like Chicago. No, I think Chicago has a definite accent.
Right. Like, but Chicago lends you that gift of when you leave it, you become very there's no accent.
Right.
When I first came from there, I would wait tables at Jekyll and Hyde. I'd be like, what y'all want? And they were like, where are you from? I was like, what you mean?
Yeah. Interesting you said South Africa in there, because all I remember, 1983, my band was offered a huge band. Amount of money to go play in South Africa. But at that point, it was still apartheid. It was Sun City, don't play Sun City, that kind of thing. And they were bringing in white American audiences, but we weren't all white. We had black people in the band, and it was a real issue for us. We turned it down, and it was for us. We were all poor, and for that, for us to turn down a great amount of money like that, it was like taking a stand against something. But now everybody goes to South Africa, right? When did you go?
I went almost 18 years ago. It was a long time ago. And I didn't really understand. I was very young. And they had booked me at a show called Blacks Only by David Kao. That's his name. He's a famous comedian over there. He was actually more famous than Trevor Noah. And he's still very well known there. And he just saw me like, even then, I think it was either on YouTube or Last Comic Standing. And he booked me out. And I did not understand that I should have stayed longer than I did, because I was like, I'll just go and come back. Like, I was like, it was like an overnight gig for me. I was just so, yeah, like, I'm just like, I'm going to the Hamptons, going to drive home. I didn't get it. I went, I was there for, I think, the show. I got there the night before the show, the day after, and left like 2 days, maybe a day or two after. It was crazy what I did. But I did, in that time, I did meet Winnie Mandela. Wow. Because he was close with the family. So like, he said, I could take you to a day ride, which is like a zoo. That's what they call a zoo. Or I could introduce you to Winnie Mandela. And I was like, I don't know. And then one day we were just driving through Alexandria, and which is like one of their towns. It's like really intense. And we drove through, and then we went to this restaurant to eat, and he surprised me with meeting Winnie Mandela. And the whole time I kept saying, I'm home, and no one would say, yes, you are. Cause it's my joke. I'm like, I'm home. And they're like, no, they were like, don't do that. And I said it to Winnie Mandela. I didn't say it to Winnie Mandela. Winnie said it to me. She goes, welcome home.
Wow.
And I was like, oh my God, thank you. And very then cool. My hair locked with her wig, and it was almost a bad moment. But that's a whole other story. So
welcome home. We're going to put you in prison.
I know. There's a lot of that I didn't get into. I just was like, hello. But because there is security. So, but it was also that Mandela's children were there, and it was just a beautiful moment. And I remember performing on that stage. It was in a casino. It was a filled room. It was like packed. It was like almost like doing Madison Square Garden.
Wow.
And they got my material. And it was just such a beautiful experience of going there and resonating with them with the same material that I would do in New York.
Wow. Very cool. I got to I know I don't want to keep you, over.
I'm having so much fun with you.
I appreciate that. Well, but it's important for Abby that I mention that you're at Sticks and Stones Friday night, this Friday night. I think it's 8 p.m. the show. Right?
I think it's two shows.
Two shows. And you're with Matt Ritter. Have you ever worked with him before?
I've never met Matt Ritter, but I'm looking forward to it.
Okay. It's just interesting because
that last name rings a bell.
Yeah. Well, Tex Ritter, but I don't think he's related. And John Ritter, Tex Ritter, who was the old cowboy guy from the early 1900s, was a big star. John Ritter from Three's Company was his son. I never knew that. But I thought, and when I saw the name Matt Ritter, I thought automatically.
I did a lot of AI-ing. Did a lot of Googling. I was like, who is? I need to know who he's the son of.
Right.
I love John Ritter. John Ritter was one of the ones that actually got me, believe it or not, into comedy. Right. One of. Loved him. So I was like, Matt Ritter?
Right. When did you talk about getting into comedy? Was this something like you wanted to do from childhood, or did it come later in life?
Day one, out of my mom's, no. comedy. No, I just comedy. Was always, it was something that found me, but I was always, when I look back on it, I was always funny, and I was always trying to find ways to fit in. That was really comedy was my defense mechanism for being sort of the the one that wasn't fitting. Because I did grow up in Highland Park, Illinois, which was predominantly white, mostly Jewish, actually. My dad knew some people, so he got in. And then we moved to the south side of Chicago. So I went from being the only black child in all white neighborhood to being the only white child in all black neighborhood. Yeah. So I was a bit of a chameleon. So I had to and I still do it to this day. It's one of my things. I can impersonate people. If I'm around someone enough, I just start to become them. Like Zelig. Do you ever see Zelig with Woody Allen where he's on an elevator with black men and all of a sudden he's like turning black? Is not blackface, but you know. But it's like I just become what it is, and it's odd. And it was always funny to people.
Right.
And I did say in school I wanted to be a clown now, but I didn't, and then I just found my way through performance, and I didn't know what that was. I would do theater in high school. I would do a monologue pieces. I did speech team any way I could. I was performing in front of people when I was in college, University of Illinois. I did a one woman monologue with The Invisible Man by Ralph Ellison in front of like 1,200 people. I was very angry. I was like, I was trying to find my way. And I always said to myself, if this doesn't work out, I'm doing stand up and just making people laugh. And I did it. I came to New York. I went to Syracuse for theater, moved to New York. My roommate said, loved all my stories about my grandma Moot. And I made him laugh, and then I said, I'm gonna start doing some stand up. I went to Gotham Comedy Club, and that was it.
Wow, that's interesting that you're talking about becoming the people you surround yourself with. I ran away from home, and I went to Lake Wales, Florida, in high school, and put myself through high school. And Lake Wales at that time, Central Florida, was 98% black, and I was like the only white kid. I was standing out in the white kid.
Are you okay?
Yeah, kind of. But it's funny because I started to talk very rural black, and people did not appreciate it. People who saw me, and it took a while for me to lose that after, you know, and just find myself again, realize who I was. But I know,
but you were that. That's how you grew up.
Right. It's kind of like it becomes part of you.
Yeah.
It's very strange the way you human beings can acclimate to their surroundings and become whatever they are. And you know what? That's kind of hope for us, at least, that we understand. It helps you understand that we are all just people in the end, and because, you know, you live with it and you become, it becomes part of who you are. Before I let you go, I just want to talk about you, single black female. You're very attractive, young lady, and you say you're older than I thought. But with that single, is that
still true?
Is it by choice?
Are you asking me on a date? Where'd you marry?
Well, no, I'm too old for that anyway.
I put myself on silver singles on the dating app, but then I was like, maybe not.
Is that by choice? Is that you just prefer the single lifestyle, or is you just because I thought in one of your bits you talk about you become, I don't know, a little more discerning.
It's definitely me. I have a problem. No, I'm trying to figure it out. It's just really tough out here. I am not supposed to be out here right now. I'm supposed in your 50s, you're supposed to be divorced and then starting over. I have never, you know what it is? I've always made comedy my first love. And that is the truth.
I know.
I've always been a love of this craft so much. So it is like a drug. It's like heroin for me. I have to do it. I love it.
Believe
so anything
me.
That gets in the way of that, you got to go. Right. So, like, my first boyfriend that I dated, he actually lived in Long Island.
Long Island.
Long Island. He lived in the island?
Yeah, well, it sounds like the Jewish part of Chicago.
Long Island.
Yes.
I am actually 12% Ashkenazi, but so I could say. But no. But he was Haitian, and culturally, they just liked their woman to stay home. And not all of them, obviously, but his family in particular was right from Haiti. And they were like, what are you doing? They say, Marina, you got to cook for him. You got to do the food. And I was like, what? I have sets. I have to go out and do like 10 minutes and get better. What are you talking about? They were like, look at you don't clean his toilet. He can clean. Doesn't he know how to clean his own damn bathroom? So it was that decision of just focusing on my career. And then it just got away from me. And I just forgot to like commit to someone. Right. And then I made a lot of mistakes. You know, I dated young because I aged well. I did get a lot of young guys that would come at me. Never will do that again. And I tell everyone in their 40s, you have a clock that's ticking. So if you're going to date young, you gotta make sure you know what you're getting into.
Right.
So, but it's also like this. I like this young generation that looks at me as a hero because I'm single. Like my nieces are like, they call me TT. They're like, TT, you ain't got to be with no one. We love this. I was like, you're young. You don't know what you're talking about. Shut up. I need someone to take care of me when I get older. Be quiet.
Yeah, you know, I hear you and I hear them. I have been a terrible husband. I think anybody who's in the arts makes a terrible partner. And I'm always fascinated to see two people. Like, I've seen a lot of people who are comedians get married, you know, male and female comedians.
Bonnie and Rich Voss.
Yeah.
Famous couple.
Right. And Katie and Mike, Katie Hannigan and Mike Vecchione.
Vecchione.
Yeah. Joe List and Sarah.
Is it Vecchione? Have I been saying it wrong this whole time?
I don't know. Okay. don't ever pronounce a name based on how I do, because okay. I screw shit up all the time.
Mike Vecchione.
Yeah, but so it's got to be fascinating to be two creative people, because I know I've been a terrible husband. My wife always says, I wish you would hold me like you hold that guitar. I was like, that's not never going to happen. We'll get that out of your mind, because I can't. My creative desire to do things creatively always overweighs my relationship duties and in anything that comes up. No, I gotta do what I gotta do. And this weekend I have eight coming up on 8 gigs. I have 7 booked right now, but I think there's another one coming.
Nice.
Yeah, but that means no time with the family, and they have to understand that. So I get what you're saying, but I
you're a happier person because of it. They need to know that too.
Yeah.
You know, but I would say this: I am dating and I am open. I've been on 3 dates. But I am out there and I'm more open than I've ever been before. And I was always in sort of a relationship. I was in one right up until about 2018 with a guy from England, a brother from England. And so I talk about that on stage, and it's possibly that I put too much of their business out on the street too. I could have done that.
Yeah. Well, it always is interesting to me to see comedians on stage and to think about how their significant other feels about them talking. So
not good. So, not good.
Yeah. And I know now from doing this that my wife never listens to this show for good reason, because she doesn't want to hear what I have to say. But at some point, it will get back to her and she'll be like, what? And my brother has called me several times to say, what do you tell people about me? I don't know what to say. Before I let you go, Friends Like Us, how often do you do it? When does it come out?
It comes out every Wednesday. So we have an episode tomorrow that will be released with so every Wednesday. Tomorrow we have an episode with a woman, Kiana Webb. We start to mix it up with entrepreneurs and people who really like are successful Black women in the industry, and we'll talk with them about, she had the most McDonald's franchises as a Black woman. I was like, okay. And so we talked to her about being an entrepreneur, and we've had a couple of guests. We had DC Benny, who's out there in Norfolk. by the way. DC Benny was recently. He was our guy for the month. So we do. We have like a white for, and we have a guy for our period. And DC was that. If you don't know DC Benny, he has a special. He put out something on YouTube. It's a special that he put out. So we wanted to promote him.
You know, that's interesting, because I was thinking about this morning that there's a lot of comedians doing the YouTube thing now. Joe List just did one on YouTube, and he said that they over-censored him, but they didn't censor anything. All they did was limit the advertising budget on it. And I guess if you get enough views, you can make it pay, but it's always interesting to me, like, because it feels like you're giving it away when you do it on YouTube. And one thing I respect about you is, you know, all your stuff is on like Hulu or like, you know, Comedy Central or Comedy Dynamics, or, you know, it's not giving it away. I think you devalue your art when you just give it away like that, and it kind of sends a bad message to the audience, like that they should expect stuff for free, and then you can't complain about not making any money when you're training your audience to expect it for free.
Well, a lot of these guys are doing that, and it's working for them, though. Like my Joe List did it, Mark Norman did it for a while, and they built up an audience because those guys are really great writers, and they're never going to be lacking with material, so they're not worried about losing material. And I would say Joe List also has a pretty good fan base because of it, whereas if he just waited for the industry to give him something, no one would be there. Right. So he's a good example of that. There's a couple of people, there's another comedian who did that. He has over a million views,
right?
And now he's doing Netflix. And the same thing happened with Mark Norman. Netflix didn't give him a special. He put his stuff out on YouTube, and then they were like, let's give you a special.
Yeah. So he's blowing up now.
It's from comedy, doing it on YouTube.
Yeah. And yeah, you're right. I appreciate that. But on the other side of it, when they talk about YouTube censoring your stuff and worrying about what you can say, that, you know.
That's interesting. Yeah, I didn't know that.
Yeah. I don't know. Because now Steve Byrne started some Punch Up, is what it's called. An alternative for just comedians. A comedian network. It's like a YouTube thing for comedians. And they're not censoring anything. And Joe put his special on there, but it's got 400,000 views in a week on YouTube. So I think that's doing pretty well.
That's Mateo Lane is another example. So like Mateo Lane built up his social media, put his special out on YouTube, his second one. It has, I don't know how many views, but I think it had over 100,000 in like 2 days. And he's doing Carnegie Hall.
Right.
I think he was even, like, so he's getting the road work based on the numbers. So like, you know, this whole idea, you know, it's kind of like Netflix is like catch up, right? So like people go, when are you doing a Netflix special? Now I've actually been walking on the streets of Chicago, and I had a girl go, Marina Franklin? I go, yeah. I just saw you on YouTube. I was like, that's a sign that something's changing and shifting.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, very good. I got to ask you one more thing, because I know I've been saying I'm going to be respectful of your time, and then I'm not.
No, I love it. It's fun. What am I going to do? I just am waiting for the laundry guy.
Oh, okay. You're playing Sticks and Stones on this weekend, Labor Day weekend. I don't know if you know The Room, but it's more like a theater. It's gradient seating, which you don't find in comedy clubs anywhere. It's kind of that, you know, that kind of thing. The stage is here, and then it's up, like, you know, angled up like a theater.
Mm-hmm, yeah.
Theaters versus comedy clubs, it's a different experience. And you mentioned before playing like felt like Madison Square Garden, the venue you played, those huge rooms, theater, different approach to your work when the room is different like that.
It's better for me. It's better because I do come from the theater. Remember, no. Right.
Theater training, yeah.
I am from the theater. I was supposed to be doing Shakespeare, but I am now a clown for you. So, no, the theater is the theater is where, like I said, I do feel at home in those spaces, and it's where actually I do my best work, mostly because they're listening. I don't know if they serve food, but comedy clubs can be challenging in that way. It can be somewhat, you know, about selling nachos and drinks. It can be, not always, not all clubs, but it can be. Whereas a theater is really like the audience is making a choice to see you and listen. And so in that way, I get to explore on stage in a great way. Now, it's also like depending on the space, but I'm excited. I spoke to Abby. I said, I am so ready to get out of the city. And on the last weekend of the summer, are you kidding? I'm just so happy to be there. I genuinely, sometimes I'll say that and I'll be like, I'm so happy to be there. I really, really am happy to be in Southampton.
Good. And that's always the best attitude to go into it with. And that room is a laughing room, despite the gradient seating and theater like feeling to it. But I think there is a difference in audience reaction. In theaters, they're more, where in comedy clubs, they're more laughing. And to me, I prefer laughing than clapping. Does it make a difference from you energetically?
I'll stop those claps.
Oh, you do?
Oh, yes. I will address it, and I'll be like, listen, y'all better start laughing and less clapping. So there's a way, there's a skill, there's a way to do it. I stop clapping and awes, any type of awe.
What does that mean?
Awes ruin shows. You get triggered, you know, people get triggered nowadays. So you'll have someone in the audience go, oh, and then all of a sudden the rest of the audience is going, oh. It's just like laughter is contagious. Awes are contagious.
Well, I like the way Louis C.K. handles that, actually, because he definitely sets it up with it. Wait, you can't go there now. You laughed at the dead baby joke. You're with me for this thing.
yes.
Yeah,
so you train him.
Yeah, so it's just a whole different thing. And I used to work for a healing cult years ago.
A what?
Healing cult. Energy healers. We're going to fix your auras and make you whole again and all that kind of stuff. But they used to talk about how clapping breaks the energy. It ruins the energy. And people do. We've been trained to do that to show appreciation, but it actually ruins the energy of the moment for everybody. And I don't know if there's any.
There can be applause breaks that are good,
right?
But then too much clapping is, it can ruin the rhythm. You know, I've been known to, people say I have great rhythm on stage. So clapping can sort of mess with that dance that I have with the audience. It breaks it up. So yeah. You guys can have clapping breaks.
Right.
Like, you know, that's fine.
Clap hard when I'm done.
But you don't want to stop an audience from really feeling joy. And that is what a clap is about, is that they're in agreement with you, and you don't want to attack them for that. We want, some comedians will, and I get that too, but you don't want to. You want to, like, just in a humorous way, just show them that this is now a joke, and laughter is so much better, isn't it?
Right. Yeah. Well, I have your website in the scroll there, marinafranklin.com. It's important that you put the .com, folks. And it's in the link, because if you don't use a .com, if you use one of the other extensions, I think you get a boatyard.
Who's not using .com?
Huh?
Who's not using .com?
Well, people use .net. People use, you know, all sorts of .TV is one now. Awesome. But there is a Marina Franklin dot something else. That's a boatyard in a town called Franklin. So you don't want to go there.
And I am not the storm that's coming. Franklin's anyway, coming.
If I were not gigging myself this weekend, I would be there. I'm a little sad that I'm going to miss your show, but hopefully next time or sometime in the future, I will get into New York City Comedy Cellar.
What are you playing?
This week I'm at Catch in Venetian Shores, an outdoor like amphitheater on the Great South Bay on Long Island.
No, but music-wise, like what?
Well, I'm a writer. My band is, we do lots of cover material, but we are essentially an original band. We do a lot of material that I write.
Fantastic. You know, I gotta check it out.
Yeah. You know, I was talking about this earlier or yesterday, I think. I also do a lot of nursing homes, assisted living. I enjoy playing solo guitar, walking around nursing homes more than I enjoy playing with the band for a full audience. Tomorrow there'll be several thousand people in there enjoying the full band, and I will take less satisfaction and less, you know, soul-filling enjoyment from it than I do for walking around a nursing home and walking into an old person's room and playing one song for them and just seeing how it affects their life. Because you get to really feel that you've made a difference with somebody. You've changed their day. Where when you're playing for a room full of people, they're happy, they're drinking, they're dancing, but it's not really, you don't really feel like you've done anything to improve their life. But
that's right. Yeah. Oh, that's beautiful. I'm going to check you out.
Oh, I appreciate it.
What's the band called?
The Rockin' 45s.
Oh, I like that. Okay, let's check it out. That's beautiful. I need it too. Yeah.
Yeah, I'm urging everybody to get out to Southampton this weekend. Most people are out here anyway. This is the last hurrah this weekend, so I expect you're going to have a great show. Look forward to it. And thank you for coming on. And
thanks for having me.
Knock 'em dead.
Thank you so much.
Okay, have a great morning.
You bye too. Bye-bye.
Marina Franklin, folks, Sticks and Stones Comedy, Friday night, two shows. I don't know why. Hold on a second. Let me see here. Two shows. I got to get the time for it. 7 p.m. and 9 p.m., Sticks and Stones Comedy. Anyway, she's going to be there with Matt Ritter, who is not in any way related to John Ritter. I don't know. I'll have to ask him about this. He's going to be here tomorrow. Matt Ritter will be here tomorrow. I believe he's not in any way related to John Ritter or Tex Ritter, who was John Ritter's father, which would make sense if he's not related to one, he's not related to the other. I'm just talking. Sometimes I should just shut up. And this is one of those times. We're brought to you all by True Fire. True Fire is one of the best ways to learn, actually the best way to learn guitar online. True Fire, check them out. I'll be right back.
Over 2 million guitar players worldwide learn, practice, and play with True Fire. Our learning tools and massive library of video lessons will ignite your technical skills, harmonic knowledge, rhythm playing, and soloing chops. True Fire's educators are the best in the biz, from Grammy Award winners to world-renowned artists. You'll have access to an unparalleled faculty of over 300 top-notch blues, rock, jazz, country, fingerstyle, and acoustic guitar educators. Using our desktop and mobile apps, you'll work with True Fire's multi-angle video lessons on any device, anytime, anywhere. Integrated learning tools such as video sync, tab and notation, slow-mo, looping, practice jam tracks, and many more handy controls accelerate your learning experience. True Fire style-specific learning paths guide you every step of the way. Use our assessment tools to find your starting point, then follow our lesson recommendations and track your progress as you work through your personalized True Fire study plan. Progress faster with private one-on-one instruction, group lessons, multi-track video jams, live streams, song lessons, student forums, True Fire's Riff magazine, premium jam tracks, and much, much more. With thousands of five-star ratings and reviews from amateur and pro players alike, you'll find yourself in good company with the world's most comprehensive guitar learning platform. Grab your guitar and ignite your musicality. Sign up free for an all-access trial today.
You know, you can go to sticksandstonescomedyclub.com to order your tickets. Still some seats available for Friday night and Saturday night with Diane Forrest, who's going to be in the second hour tomorrow. So do that. Go to Sticks and Stones Comedy Club. A lot of cool things happening at Sticks and Stones coming up. They're doing some really creative things, more than just comedy. Anyway, I hope you enjoyed that. Marie, she's a really, really nice person and funny. Funny as hell. Watch her special. You know, it's not often that I laugh, truly laugh out loud watching a special online, but there were definitely a good 5 or 10 laugh out loud moments for me watching her special called Single Black Female. Interesting stuff, interesting takes on some things, and very, very funny young lady, and I guess not as young as I thought. She looks young. Anyway, hope you enjoyed that. No show tonight. Good thing. I got some things going on. Tomorrow, as mentioned, Matt Ritter will be here and Diane Forrest. And then I have another show tomorrow evening with McShorn Daniel, who is a author. Then on Thursday, Dwight Little, who is a filmmaker and who has written a book now, a very successful filmmaker. I'll list his credits on Thursday when he's here, but you would know all the films that he's been part of. And Friday, it's looking like I'm thinking about not doing a show on Friday because I have now seven gigs booked for the weekend, maybe an eighth for Friday morning. So I'll let you know tomorrow whether we're actually going to do a show on Friday. You know, I hate to let you down. I all my seven people watching right now. No, eight people watching right now. Oh, by the way, LinkedIn, the chat room, don't abuse the chat room. The people on LinkedIn over there, I don't know what's gotten into some of you people. I'm not paying much attention to that chat room. I have been looking at one YouTube chat room that Ian looks to be alone in there, and then the Gov's YouTube chat room, which is nice, and the Rumble chat room I'm actually seeing right now. Rumble stuff, they're all well-behaved. LinkedIn, get your shit together and don't, you know, I hate to ban people and block people, but you know, so you know what I'm talking about, and I'm not going to broadcast it, but some of the comments this morning, and you know what I'm talking about, Adeline, not cool at all. And don't make me be a blocker. I don't want to be a blocker. Anyway, that's the show for you today. I don't know what you think about it, what you thought about it. I'd love to hear from you. info@minddogtv.com. Do me a favor. Go to my website and get on my mailing list. Don't forget, I am running for Congress. And although I'm not taking any donations or any of that stuff, I am writing a kind of a tricky thing here because I am still promoting this show and obviously still, you know, a capitalist at heart and looking to make a couple of bucks here. So keep that in mind and go to minddogtv.com and support us. Download the app. If you haven't already, I know the people over there, you people, I'm talking to you, the radio people, you already got the app. I've seen the numbers going up with the app downloads. Not necessarily seeing the listening traffic increase during the day. Now, people are enjoying the music, and that's great. Enjoy the music 24/7. There's lots of streaming variety of music. You can get rid of your Sirius XM bill. By the way, Sirius XM, I don't know if you know this, might be in some trouble here. There's some indicators. They are ending their podcast. I think they got this wrong, by the way. They're ending their podcast service called Stitcher and focusing more, you know, on. So you're going to lose all, if you are inclined to want to listen to your Sirius XM shows, you know, the show, the comedy shows, as a podcast and on demand, you're going to lose the ability to do that. They're taking that away and they're dumping podcasting altogether and focusing on Sirius on the satellite radio. I think that's a mistake. I think podcasting is going to overtake satellite radio. I think satellite radio, you know, people, you're paying for the right to listen to what you can get for free right here. Not just here, but every other podcast out there. You get your podcast app and your Bluetooth, and you can take that with you in your car. No reason to be on. I am bashing SiriusXM because I'm not on there. If I were on there, and don't think I don't want to be on there. But if I were on there, I wouldn't be bashing it. I'd be telling you it's great. It's the wave of the future. Nothing beat it. But I'm not on there. And I am a little concerned that they're going the wrong way. Don't dump the podcast thing. Dump the satellite thing. Stick with the podcasting stuff. Anyway, you can free to argue with me about that. Write to me at info@minddogtv.com. I love your hate mail. I hate your love mail. And I like your like mail. I'm going to go take care of the dog. I'm going to go walk the dog. Have a great day. And let's see. Don't forget to, what the hell is it? Turn something on. Oh, your radio. Don't forget to turn on your radio.
Oh, me now. Listen to me, listen to me, listen to me now. Listen to me, listen to me, listen to me now. Listen to me, listen to me, listen to me now.